Hi, my name's Swada, and I'm a rising senior at the Harrox High School in New York, but I was born and raised in Mumbai, India for the first 16 years of my life. And this is my best friend Sameeksha, and we work on the Period Society, which is a non-profit to increase access to menstrual hygiene products and menstrual hygiene in low-income communities. And I primarily began this project to based on my own life experiences and the frustration that I felt living under the menstrual taboo in India. And it wasn't really to create something, but it was more about converting my frustration and my anger into productive social change, and to make sure the kind of experiences that I had as a girl just aren't considered normal in society anymore, right? And I'll let Sameeksha introduce herself and then talk a little bit more about the Period Society.
So hi, I'm Sameeksha. I live in Singapore. Till sixth grade, I was in India and I was in the same school as Swara. That's where we became best friends. And we've kept in touch for almost 6 years now. I'm also doing IBM in year 12. And I joined Swara and the Period Society after I heard about it from her. This is something I experienced as well, like the taboo around menstruation. And as an Indian girl, I feel like, once again, I didn't want these experiences to be universal. I wanted them to be one of experiences that we understand are not normal in our society.
And while we primarily work in slums, villages, and in low-income communities, I think the menstrual taboo really extends to girls, like no matter what section of society they come from. Because the first time I heard the word periods, it was on a Whispers ad, and like I saw something that looked like a diaper and there was a blue liquid on it, and I couldn't relate to that because there's nothing blue inside of my body. And when I was on the school bus in the third grade, some of the girls just like whispered periods in a really low voice, and when I went like, what are periods, they told me to like shut up and like not be loud, because apparently it was something that was vulgar and you weren't supposed to speak about in society. And then fast forward to when I'm 12, I get my periods. Mom sits me down and tells me that I'm not supposed to go worship in the temple, I'm not supposed to touch food because it could get spoiled. I'm never supposed to publicly announce or talk to a man about my periods because that's something that's vulgar again. But no one tells me what periods are. I know that I'm going to bleed every month, but I don't know where that blood comes from. So it was so easy to believe in all of these superstitions that your body's shedding negativity, it's the time of the month when you're impure, when you don't really realize that it's such a normal biological process. Which is why when we work in low-income communities, we explain them the entire process with the help of videos, talks, and diagrams. Because once you realize that you're really just shedding the uterine lining of your blood every month, and it's something that's so normal, it's very difficult to believe that your body's like shedding negativity, or it's something that's impure, it's something that's a taboo. And I honestly waited for a time when people would come to accept this as something that's normal and people would just talk about periods freely. But I lived in a country for most of my life where the government considers sanitary napkins to be a luxury product, and like sindoors sold tax-free to women because it's important and it's a part of our culture. And I live in a country where my neighbors visited the Kamakhya temple to worship a menstruating goddess, but every time I menstruated, I wasn't supposed to go to their house in festivals, or they take a bath again and purify the house.
I'm very, very grateful that my family is quite liberal, and I was the idea and concept of periods was explained to me pretty well. And I think in that privilege, I refused to consider for a large part of my life that other women weren't afforded the same mentality. But when I did, then I watched the movie, I think most people know about like Padman, and I still had quite a few questions. Like, the movie wasn't fully complete because I thought about so many ideas that weren't mentioned within that movie. And I thought, and when Swara introduced this concept to me that she was coming up with, I thought it was a great opportunity for me to get involved, to kind of understand that my privilege means that I must help other people who aren't at the same economic, social, or cultural like opportunities that I've had.
And while we currently focus on menstrual hygiene education and on menstruation, in the future, I plan to expand our scope to the reproductive health of women, because I want society to realize that words like vagina, uterus, breast cancer, these aren't vulgar words, these are part of a conversation. And in a society where like people die because of sepsis, because they use ash and grass when they have their periods, when like the increasing rates of breast and cervical cancer, you can't really talk about good health and well-being without considering your reproductive health, which is essential to like every single woman on this planet.
And I think that we believe that women's health is a human health issue. So this isn't just a women's issue, just women are participating in it. We're open to like people from all walks of life, all genders, everyone who believes in different sort of things. We want to open up the conversation and we want to bring them towards a part where they're free to understand the biological aspect of it, but also the social taboos that govern over them.
And just a thought that I'd like to leave everyone with is that when you look at people who are poor, people who live in slums, or people who are homeless, you often wonder, oh, where do they get their food from? When it rains, where do they get shelter from? But do you ever look at a homeless woman, do you ever think, oh my God, where does she get a sanitary napkin from when she has her periods? Because we do not talk about menstruation, and even though we need our sanitary napkins all the time, menstrual hygiene products are a necessity. We don't think of them as a human right or a basic need, which is why we ignore so many women around the world who don't have access to these period products. And I think it's very important that we open up the conversation about periods and like defeat the taboos which have been internalized in us by our society and work to improve access to these products and make this part of our normal conversations.
So as communications director who handles social media and like sometimes content, very often I hear that our generation, Gen Z, is disconnected from the real world. And I would completely argue differently. I think we're more connected than we've ever been before. Like our team is 20 people from 3 different countries and 10 different cities across the world. They contribute so much to our organization. And I think like the best part about being in Gen Z and making small changes is that you don't have to physically be at that spot to help any cause. You can do it from right where you are. If you're at home, if you're at work, if you're at school, you can do it from right where you are with the help of your phone, with the help of your laptop, with the help of people around you. And that's what we want to promote in the peer society as well, because we want to tell them, we want to tell young people that you don't have to fly all the way to India or from wherever you are in order to help women here. You can get on your phone, join us, become a help us in communicating to other people, use your power that you have that you don't realize with your social media, and join a cause that you believe in.
And to add on to what Sameeksha said, the funny thing is that like most of our volunteers are people who we met over Instagram when we released applications, and they're the people who work the hardest. And I haven't met Sameeksha in person for 5 years, but she's running our social media. And all of our outreach coordinators are not based in New York, and we've been communicating online, and they've been doing a fantastic job. And more than that, my message to Gen Z is that realize when you begin to start something like this, you are going to make mistakes, but that's completely okay. In the beginning, I didn't know how to like run a nonprofit, begin something like this, so I reached out to help. There were students in my high school who were involved in youth activism. If Pranjal Jain's hearing this, she's an activist at my school who mentored me and helped me begin this project. And I think there's so many resources in our community, such as people who are already established social justice advocates who are willing to help you and give you advice for your projects. Like just find them on Instagram, look up their profiles and reach out to them. And I think there's so many students who are willing to join your cause, like the people who I never met before from different parts of the world who joined the Period Society and are helping me carry this, and it wouldn't be possible without them. And also realize that like you will make mistakes in the beginning, but you have to start at some point. I like always thought that I'm 17, no one's gonna take me seriously. And I did feel discouraged in the beginning when I emailed people, no one got back to me. People straight out went like no for events. Before I reached out to my first youth-driven organization, which is Enactus at HR College. And they collaborated with us, and we purchased eco-friendly sanitary napkins from them. And in our very first fundraiser, we managed to raise $2,000, and we're reaching out to over 700 women and meeting the menstrual hygiene needs for the next 3 years this August itself. But realize that before all of this impact took place, I had to deal with like rejections, people who told me that I wasn't old enough, I wasn't good enough, I didn't know what I was doing as a school going kid. And it's really important that you accept mistakes as an organic part of the process and just still move ahead because your passion drives you.
Sorry, just to add to what Swara is saying as well, if you're someone looking to join a project that's already set up, like I did to Swara, like I did with the Peers or Society, I would suggest that don't feel afraid if you think you're not qualified enough. I think everyone learns as they go along, and also by just volunteering, even if you don't do much, by just helping out a little bit, you're contributing quite a bit to any organization you join.